I've often thought that Christians should regard ourselves, as Abraham and Sarah did, as a people passing through this land that God has given us, always keeping our sights set on that heavenly kingdom which is our true homeland. Other great Christian thinkers of our time have reflected that Christians are resident aliens in an American culture that claims some Christian identity but has drifted a long way from the path of Jesus. Resident aliens. This year, though, as I read this text with you all in my heart and in my mind, I thought about just how many of you are or have been actual resident aliens in this country. That status is not a spiritual experience, but an everyday reality that often comes with great hardship or with discrimination. So what does it mean to say that all Christians, even those who enjoy a great amount of privilege in this country, should live like strangers and foreigners on the earth? What especially does it mean to say that in a multicultural congregation on the Sunday before our nation celebrates the 240th anniversary of our independence? I thought perhaps the best way is to ask you, those of you who know best what it is to be a stranger and a foreigner or a resident alien. What does that mean to you? Are there any of you who are here today who would be willing to share a story, a short story, about a time when you have felt like an outsider here? A time when maybe you felt like you weren't welcome or didn't belong? A time when you felt like a stranger and a foreigner? Or for those of you who have lived here for many generations, if you've ever lived in another country, and you would be willing to share a story of a time when you have felt like an outsider there. Is there any who are willing? That's not easy stories to tell. Are there any who are willing to share?
I have a little one. Yeah, when I first started coming here, the communion service was really different from anything I'd ever done. And so every time I had to play the responses, I was afraid I was going to do it wrong. So it took me a little while to get used to that. All I must say, people here have been very loving.
Very grateful. Yeah. Anyone who is an immigrant to this country willing to share a story of what it's like to be foreigner?
I'm not preaching.
Short story. It's dangerous to let a preacher have a microphone.
From time to time, people ask me, you feel at home here yet? And no. So you want to go back to the country, live there? No. So I'm lost between these two worlds. And here I say more freedom, good food, good drink, right? But I don't feel at home. And sometimes I feel I'm a stranger, isolated. Well, with my family it's okay, with my close friends it's okay. But when I walk around the neighborhood, the city, people never say, hello, hi, how are you? Are you family? No. When I went back to my country, well, I still have good memory. But what I had before, gone. And people look to me as a stranger. Mm. I'm lost, but here we are.
Thanks.
God is good, and all the time. I see you know just by the grace of God, God has blessed us with a beautiful home. And I remember it was afternoon one day, I was driving to my house just to park my car. and there was a construction that was going on at the time, you know, the police officer. So as soon as I turned my light, going to my driveway, the officer rushed to me, and he's like, "What are you thinking? What are you thinking? What are you thinking?" And I stayed calm, and I said, "Officer, this is my house, and I'm going home."
Citoyen means a foreign citizen. So I was look at myself like I belong in the world, in the whole world, not only in Cameroon. My family is a poor family. I never imagined one day I would find myself out of Cameroon. But after I lost my child, who was 3 months old back home in Cameroon, I decided myself to find my life somewhere else. So, my first journey was in France. I moved from Cameroon. I found myself in France with no money, just with God's blessing, with Jesus, for a lot of prayer. I moved from Cameroon to France. And then, I didn't stop my journey in France. My father, who left Cameroon, I was 6 years old. And I met him, I was 32 years old, when he came from America to visit us in Cameroon. And then he told me, when he was leaving Cameroon, I was 6 years old, one day I will come back to get you. 6 years old. After 6 years old, I was a mom. I didn't believe that story. I said, how come in all those years, one day my father will bring me this country? But I still have my belief. I'm calling myself and my cousin Sitwani tomorrow. But with God bless me, today I'm an American, I'm a citizen. And America, American citizenship means you can travel all the world, in the whole world. It means I wasn't born. I'm studying more today. Thank you.
A very short story. So when I first came here to the United States from Kenya, I was 11. And I had this very heavy Kenyan accent. And so I'm going to a middle school that's basically all white and Catholic. And I would speak and say things and nobody could really understand me. And so the biggest response I got from all the kids around me was, "What? Can you spell that?" And I learned to say, "Okay, so if you don't say it like that, how do you say it?" And eventually I started to feel more American, but that was a moment where I felt like a foreigner.
Cool story too. So I'm a therapist. What happens is my supervisor has sent cases to me. So most often I would go to a home for the first time, and I see kids most of the time. So I go to a home, knock the door, or ring the bottle, they open the door, and this is me. And several times, people have actually received me with a lot of precious loves, like help you. That's a therapist coming to help a child, you know, just in my face. And that has happened several times. And there are instances where we have had meetings, and I'm sitting in a meeting, be it with this year or any other agency and the way of talking about the case, all there to coordinate care, helping a child. And I sit there and no one is even seeing me. I'm like invisible. I have to accept myself, make the voice heard. But what I've learned is that I don't take any of this personally. I usually know that there are always some bad brains in everything. I know that people are naturally good, and I don't see especially, I see a human being. I look at person, I look at you, I take you individually who you are. I try not to be hurt by what I see or hear. Generally, people have been good to me, everything has been good, and I just want to thank God as a part of the Presbyterian Church because faith is very, very important, and I thank you all. Thank you.
For people like me who enjoy a great deal of privilege in this country, relating to Abraham and Sarah and to the author of Hebrews, means to listen to those stories of foreignness. For those of you who know all too well what it is like to be a stranger, we need to hear your stories. And I'm grateful for your courage to tell them here. I pray that this will be a safe place for those stories. But the world needs to hear your stories too. The more that the church grows in solidarity with the stranger and the foreigner in our midst, the more that we can, all of us, remember the call to live in this land, as wonderful as this land is, to remember that it is not our true home. We are citizens of another kingdom, for which we must continually long for and work toward. And that's the kingdom of God. This is also the reason why we sing hymns like Lift Every Voice and Sing. This is a hymn whose lyrics and tune were written in 1899 by African-American brothers, James and Rosalind Johnson, to celebrate the 90th anniversary of Abraham Lincoln's birth. In 1919, it was adopted by the NAACP as the Negro National Anthem. It became a freedom song of the civil rights movement in the 1960s. Race is never mentioned explicitly in the song, but you can hear the cries of the enslaved under the bitter chastening of God, the blood of slaughtered African American youth like Emmett Till and Michael Brown still cry out from the second verse. If Christians are going to embrace the call to travel through this land as strangers and as foreigners, we have to say that this song is our song. And that those stories that you heard today and the story that you hear in this hymn is our story, all of our stories. This is not the cultural appropriation of imperialism, but the enactment of the claim that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We live in the spirit of Hebrews when we listen to the voices on the margins or when we speak our voices from the margins. We do it when we share our bread with the last and least. It's what we remember at this table. We do it when we rally for the rights of immigrants. We do it when, with James Weldon Johnson, we lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring with the harmonies of liberty. May it be so. Amen.